talking about furcation involved. So what do you mean by furcation? Furcation, as you know, is an area of complex anatomic morphology that once involved is difficult to deploy by routine periodontal instrumentation. What do you mean by that? See, furcation is actually the space between the bifurcation or trifurcation of multi-rooted teeth. So what happens there is like the patient as well as the dentist won't get access to clean up that area during the routine instrumentation. So and even after that, for maintenance by the patient, it's going to be difficult because of lack of access. So this area is going to be the most common source of infection for any human. So first of all, before going into it, we have to know about the classification. So how do you classify it? See, Glickman in 1953 has classified it into grade 1. That is the incipient stage, which has got supraponial pockets, slight bone loss, and in the radiograph, there may be change or they may not be change visible. In grade 2, it's called as Tully sac. And what do you mean by Tully sac? That means one part of the, one side of the bone is involved, whereas the other side of the ossification area is kept intact. So that is why, and it looks like a cave. That's why it's called as a Tully sac. And in this, radiographically, it may or may not be present by the new place or instrument, and then the radiograph it can be visible in grade 2. And grade 3, there is interdental bone is lost completely, but the furcation open, furcation area may not be visible completely because it will be covered by the soft tissue. And in grade 4, the furcation is new and true, just like grade 3. But what happens here is, since there is recession of the internal margin, the furcation becomes clinically very much visible. So here you can see the certain parts are open. You can see the various types of furcation involvement which is seen in different areas. And Ham et al. And Ramford Nash in 1975-1979 gave one more classification taking into consideration the horizontal and the vertical component of bone loss as degree 1, that is less than 3 mm, degree 2 is more than 3 mm on the total width, and degree 3 is true and true involvement. And Ramford and I said class 1 is beginning involvement with tissue destruction of less than 2 mm, and grade class 2 is Tully sac with more than 2 mm but not true and true, and class 3 is true and true. Here, taking into consideration the vertical component of bone loss. So why do we take the vertical component of bone loss? To establish or to find out how to manage. So this, the first classification, the most common classification which we do follow is the Glickman's classification, which is a clear indication of what the condition is all about. And then we talk about the vertical component. Why do we talk about the vertical component? To find out how or to come to a treatment plan, we need to know how much depth the defect has gone in and how much into the alveolar process the bone has gone. So we need to know about the vertical component as well as the horizontal component. So Tama and Fletcher in 1984 came out with the classification taking into consideration the vertical component, and they divided it into subclass A, subclass B and subclass C. So A denotes furcation involvement with grade A, that is furcation involvement, the vertical component will be around 1 to 3 millimeters. Grade B, it will be between 4 to 6 millimeter, and grade C is 7 millimeters and above, and that is true and true. Then coming to what causes the periodontal damage, that is etiopathogenesis of percolation diseases, mainly three factors that involve. One is plaque associated inflammation, then it is aggravated with trauma from occlusion, and then comes to contributing anatomical factors. So what do you mean by plaque associated inflammation? You know that the plaque, the extension of the inflammation takes place through the epidural area and through the ductal and limbal surfaces. So how does it, we have seen in bone patterns of bone destruction, how the inflammation goes from the marginal gingiva to the underlying root supporting structures. So once the gingivitis is left untreated, it becomes, it progresses to become periodontitis, and once it starts evolving into the supporting structures, what happens is the inflammation extends into the underlying deeper tissues. All the root supporting structures gets infected and it becomes periodontitis. And then structures and causing further and further damage. Then what are the contributing anatomical factors? Because CJs, CPs, then root trunk length, root length, and these all these things we have seen and we have discussed in detail in the beginning. So cervical anatomical collection, so CEPs, 8.6%, 28.6% of molars, which is highest maxillary mandible second molar, and it is divided and it is classified by Masters and Boston or Hoskins in 1964 into grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3. Grade 1 is exception from cementary malformation of the tooth to the forcation entrance. Grade 2, it approaches the entrance but does not enter the forcation and there is no horizontal component. And grade 3, it extends horizontally directly into the forcation. So what happens when there is a CEJ? CP. CEP, when there is a CP, you know there is an extension of the inflammation. There can be an extension of the inflammation from this region straight into the forcation region. Why? Because we know that this area does not have gingival support because the gingival does not attach to the enamel. Gingival for the geometry fibers will come into the collagen fibers can penetrate only into the cemental dentin or even maximum to the it can form a long dimensional epithelium on top of a bone only. But when there is an enamel there, it cannot get an attachment. So what happens here is the inflammation, the infection spreads from this region straight into the percussion region, leading to periodontal disease. Then root trunk length, you know that people with shorter trunks are more prone for development of location defects compared to ones with longer root trunk length. Root length determines the amount of attachment or support that a tooth will have, and people with long root trunks and short roots will have lost significant amount of support by the time the location becomes affected. Then comes the root form. We must have got about the rootings on the root surface, which this has been discussed in detail when we started the chapter. Rootings on the root surface, coupled with developmental roots and concavities, block retentive areas, basically the process of periodontal breakdown, leading to early forcation involvement. And then anatomy of the forcation, bifurcation of ridges, concavities, with the root and accessory canals, and geomolites, the block control as well as the treatment outcome. Interadicular dimension. The more they separate the roots are, the easier for you to treat it, and the more closer the roots are, it becomes for the operator to treat it. Then presence of accessory pulp canals. Once pulp is infected through accessory pulp canals, endovascular communication occurs, which causes destruction of the interdental or interadicular junction or interferes with the healing response. You can see that 81% of the patient has an orifice of 1 millimeter or less, and 53% has got a 0.75 millimeter or less. And here you can see the degree of separation. The more separated the two are, it's the more easier for you to get access for the instrumentation. Whereas if the roots are closer and closer to each other, it becomes very difficult for you to manipulate or to an instrumentation and even for the maintenance for the patient side. Then comes enamel pulse. This is another issue which occurs, which leads to formation, unnecessary formation involvements. And the incidence ranges between 1.1 and 9.7% as shown by Moscow and Canada. And in maxillary second molar, it is found mainly beyond the cementary malformation, extending into the molar bifurcation, which prevents connective tissue attachment. So how do you find out? You have to find out, you can find out through probing. So what is the probe which is used for finding out the percussion involvement? It's called the neighbor's probe. It's for a curve which goes inside the percussion area, which the normal conventional explorers cannot go in. So we have a curved probe which is called as a neighbor's probe, NABERS, neighbor's probe, which is used to find out the extent of involvement. Then come the neighbor's probe, then the bucket and lingual percussion can be easily probed with the neighbor's probe. Proximal percussions are limited, especially the maxillary tooth. The entrance of the percussion is from the interdental area and not from the buccal and lingual surface, so it becomes difficult, very tedious for us to find out. So, interproximal percussions are difficult for probing, particularly.